Hi, I'm Don Lombardi. This is Lombardi Live. We have a very special guest today. I've known him since he was 13 years old. I won't say how old I was when I met him. Thank you for joining us today, Chad, so much.
Thank you, Don.
We're going to talk about Chad Wackerman's drum room. His drum room includes lessons, the Murray Spivack method, how to kick a band, and we have some new surprises we're going to tell him about too, Chad. I've done hundreds of interviews. One of his family stories is one of the most amazing that I've ever heard. Also, the Wackerman family documentary with your brothers, Brooks, John, and Bob, and your parents is one of our most popular shows here on Drum Channel. And the drummers of Frank Zappa, also one of our most popular shows with Terry Bozzio, Ralph Humphrey, Chester Thompson, and Ruth Underwood. You know, your career is just typifies what we look at as, you know, the difference between being a great drummer and being a great musician. You've played with legendary artists, to name a few, James Taylor, Barbara Streisand, a very diverse group, which gets us into our first topic, which is just what I mentioned earlier, the difference between being a great drummer and being a great musician. For all the students that are out there, you know, what are we talking about when I say that?
Well, I tend to think all the great drummers that I look up to, I think they are great musicians, and they look at the, you can tell by the way they play because they think in the big picture of the song, sometimes of the whole album, or the whole show. It's really taking a using your ears in a wider sense, like your eyes, I guess, thinking about what you're going to do and how that's going to affect the music. And because as drummers, it takes a while to realize this, but we have more power to change the music or to set a mood than anybody else in the band. And often, you know, you can, in recording these days, a lot of recording is you get sent tracks, and sometimes there are even MIDI tracks which are non-dynamic. They're just very stagnant. By what the drummer does, by what we do, it will make those stagnant tracks sound quiet or spacious or energetic or aggressive. You know, all these different things, it's an illusion. But by what the drummer does, how much energy you put to something, how much power or how much beauty you put into it, it completely changes the music. And even more so with a live band, because if it's a good band, and I've been lucky to play in some great bands, what you do affects everybody, including the volume of the guitar player. If you start to really crank it, if you go for it, the band will rise to that level. If you start to play very quiet, they're not just going to play right through it. They're going to go down because they're good musicians or sensitive musicians, sensitive people. So that's part of being musical. And every genre is a bit different, but it's really thinking the whole, like in a recording situation or a live situation, the whole song. And does it need to go somewhere? Does it need to crescendo or have a peak to it? In pop music, it's usually, traditionally, there is a big peak at some point of the tune. So you're building the band towards that by what you play.
So we kind of say here on Drum Channel, don't tell anybody else, the drummer really is the leader of the band.
The drummer is the leader every time. Yeah, it's really true if it's admitted or not.
Okay. We just admitted it, right? Looking at, you know, the diverse, you know, group of musicians that you have played with, great major artists, and what you did as a young student in order to get ready for that, you know, it's always a matter of being prepared. The Chad Wackerman Drum Room, which we're calling it, which is an online series of courses. There also is the Chad Wackerman Drum Room. How is that going at your house, by the way? You're building an actual physical drum room.
It's going
coming
well.
Along.
It's very, very exciting. I've never really built a studio from the ground up. It's a garage conversion. But yeah, it's going to be amazing. I was lucky to have Leslie Chu, who's a great sound acoustician.
That's a new name for me.
An acoustician, yeah. Somebody who just deals in
acoustic
environment. So they're hired often to design a concert hall, to design a recording studio.
And you'll be giving lessons from there too.
Yeah, online lessons.
Live online lessons where you can actually interact with Chad.
Yeah, but it's going to be great. It has a nice high ceiling and things I've never had before. And it's just very exciting. Towards the end of the month, the live room should be done. And then building a small control room, too.
And your online series of lessons, we have a great show that we did here on Drum Channel, which was the students of Murray Spivack.
That was fun, yeah.
A lot of those people watching this right now, give them a quick little history of your relationship with Murray. In fact, the whole family.
Yeah, so my father and I took lessons from Murray at the same time. That came about because Dad and myself, one of our favorite musicians was Louis Belson. And this is back in the 70s, so I guess probably around 72, 73, dating myself. I was a kid, but...
Don't worry about dating yourself, because if you're dating yourself, I'm in big trouble.
No.
I met you when you were 13.
About that time, Dad wrote a letter to Louis Belson, I think through Pro Drum Shop, Bob Yeager and those guys, asked Louis if he would teach himself and his son, meaning me. And Louis, being the absolute gentleman that he was, he wrote a long handwritten letter basically saying, thank you very much, but he was too busy with his career at that time, with his big band Explosion and backing his wife Pearl Bailey. And but he recommended that we go to his teacher, which was Murray Spivack. And then Dad called up Murray, got his number through Louis. Murray Spivack, in the phone conversation, he said, well, I'm booked up for 6 months, but I'll put you on the list. So sure enough, in 6 months, we got a call and we started taking lessons. So we drove up about an hour drive from where we lived to Hollywood to this recording studio, and he had a room in Annex Studios in Hollywood. And we started taking lessons. That changed everything for me as far as hand technique went and reading, snare drum, classical interpretation, stuff like that. But the basic motions and the way he taught the fundamentals was completely unique. And I think all of his students credit him as being kind of a lifesaver for longevity in drumming, not ever hurting yourself, playing in a way where it's very, very efficient and you're doing the least amount of effort for the maximum result.
So it included David Garibaldi, who was in the round table with the students of Murray Spivack.
All my brothers, yeah.
Long history of family members who...
And John, my dad, Chuck Wackerman, John Brooks, my bass player brother Bob even took a few lessons on reading from him. It was revolutionary.
And what you're doing with the series of lessons that you put together within your drum room is kind of reliving the way he taught you through that almost two-year period. Every other week, there's 30
right.
lessons. So
it's sequential.
Yeah.
Yeah, he had a very, very methodical method. And as you know, through the Murray Spivack course that we did together, he had a way of teaching you one thing, then modifying it slightly, which created another pattern, which typically would be a rudiment. So the way he taught you would... You would play one thing and he'd ask you to modify it, and then he would tell you the name of what you're doing now, which is in this other rudiment, rather than looking at something fresh for the first time.
And it was mainly snare drum facility. This is getting...
It was hand technique,
This is not telling you what you're going to play with Barbra Streisand or any major artist that you're out there with.
No, he believed that style was up to you, but he would teach you to play a hand technique where you could play any style at any volume.
It's part of the real mantras we have on Drum Channel, teaching you how to play, building the machine. And I'll have to say that to some of you out there who are learning how to play by copying other people, you're not getting that foundation. It's one thing in order to see somebody doing something and reproduce it, and that's great because every drummer throughout their career is copying every drummer they can ever see in order to build their own vocabulary and their own
library. Absolutely, yeah.
But there's the foundation of why does that guy sound so good? What is the grace notes, the sensitivity,
why does it sound so easy when he does it? When I do it, it sounds difficult, and it always comes down to technique.
Yeah, a big point you brought up, I think it was in your family round table that we have here, the Wackerman family, which is also a really great education. Lots of times when you see drummers getting together and talking, you can learn as much as you do from them sitting behind the drum set and playing something. But one of the things you mentioned in that discussion was how important it is to be relaxed when you play and be comfortable. I mean, like, quintessential, you know, that's one of the things.
It is, yeah.
You make it look easy because it is easy if you practice for hours. I don't want to make it sound that easy, right? definitely takes practice. In your own personal family, very interesting to me. You told me a story which I thought was fascinating. Ties in a little bit to what you're talking about here. You do sessions sometimes where people send you tracks and it's not done live, and you know, you do some where you're actually with a band and they'll produce a live performance. But tell us a little about James, your son, and his reaction to live music and or canned, or what I would say, pre-recorded music.
Yeah, so my son has Fragile X syndrome and autism, and he's a very good drummer, which is not typical for people with Fragile X syndrome. It's a genetic developmental delay. It's intellectual disability. He does really well, but his music has always been a massive part of his life.
Of course, coming from this family, and he's a great kid too.
Yeah, he was always was always around him, I guess. And used to be the thing when he was very little to relax him, so we could go to a restaurant, even, you know, put headphones on, and he would be able to sit through a meal and things like that.
Almost like any other kid, by the way.
Yeah. Some adults too. But anyway, yeah, he's very in tune to. He just loves live records or live performances, live videos. He often asks me, "Dad, is it studio? Is it live?" You know. But when he hears the audience or can tell I think my guess is there's something about the excitement about it. There's something about the live reaction of the people and the band and the whole way it's.
Even on the radio, you had mentioned to me he could hear a song playing, and if it's whether it's live or whether it's
he can, yeah.
The idea of us having a conversation, or the idea of actually hearing another group of people, musicians, having a conversation, and how that affects one. I think it affects everybody. I think he's just so much more sensitive to it. It's just a fascinating subject.
Yeah, probably so. I mean, he loves drums. He loves music. He's often on his screen is filled up with YouTube, you know, Buddy Rich Memorial concerts and all the people we love, Greg Bissonette, Vinnie Colaiuta, you know, Buddy Rich, Louis Belson, Steve Gadd, he loves, you know. But he'll go to the live stuff for sure, yeah.
And I think that's what attracts everybody to that. I mean, that's what everybody's missing in this pandemic.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, aren't we craving it?
Yeah,
like, crazy, yeah.
Even doing Zoom calls, you're in real time, but you're still not really live.
Yeah, it's removed.
Chad, you're right there.
it's
feels
removed.
Much better than looking at a screen and talking to you, you know. And musically, I think that same thing comes through. But
yeah,
through this whole period, and even before that, I know you've done tracks before, but what have you done in your personal life that's kind of got you, kept you going through this period?
There's been a lot happening. We kind of crazily moved house during this. My girlfriend and I are now together. She has three kids, and I have two. So we've merged our families.
You've been more than busy then.
Kind of done a Brady Bunch kind of style thing. But
listen, you grew up with the Brady Bunch. Your home is the Brady Bunch.
Yeah, so that's comfortable. That's really wonderful.
In your personal family, mm-hmm. you also have a daughter who I know you're very
Sophia,
proud of.
Yeah.
It's been an interesting couple of years for her too.
Yeah, she's a student at UCLA in the jazz course there, and last season she was on American Idol.
Let's take a quick look and see if there was a major moment in your life as a father when she was on American Idol. Get on my elevator, baby, we're going up. Give me that now and later, I can't get enough. So much to discover, please don't stop me now. Every time I touch you, you lift right off the ground. Two things I have to ask as a viewer of that, being the daughter of a drummer, I can imagine maybe in the rehearsal, did she decide to tell the drummer, I want rim shots when my arm goes out, or were the rim shots
there? Yeah, she told him what beats.
Did she?
Oh, yeah. I wasn't allowed at rehearsal. I had no idea. I'd never heard her sing that tune before.
That was, yeah. So she actually went to the rehearsal and said, I'm going to.
She was funny too, because she said, Dad, I gave the guitar player 4-bar solo. Because none of the other singers would give any solos to anybody else.
You're kidding.
But no, I'm super, super proud of her.
So how did that come about, her being on Idol?
I think they have talent scouts on Idol, and they look at social media, which I was surprised at the time. But and she said, yeah, Dad, and somebody contacted me from, I don't even think they said it was American Idol. They said it was first showcase. They said it was a showcase, and can you show up in Burbank at this office building? So she did, and it was a American Idol audition, which might have been better because maybe she was probably hopefully less nervous.
And in the after, you know, when she approached you, I kind of saw the father. It's just like, my little girl is out there on stage. What happened?
Yeah, I know. I couldn't be more proud.
So there was a point when, I think it was an earlier part of the audition, when she said something, they said something about what do your parents do? And she said, my dad's a drummer. And that, they had no idea. I mean, of course, every daughter's dad's a drummer, right? He plays some, you know, dad's a drummer. So they didn't know until sometime later who you really were. I think you said they were at your house filming.
Well, no, at one point because of the pandemic, I was filming.
Well, that's right.
That was a whole other, like.
They had to come to the house and do it. That's right. It was in the middle of the pandemic.
Yeah, well, they gave us equipment. They gave us three cameras, so, three iPhones, basically.
So Chad Wackerman was actually the cameraman.
And a rack of audio gear.
Just all came in the mail.
It was delivered by FedEx, and then different weeks they'd have different like backdrops and lighting.
At the house?
It was wild. So I mean, I felt lucky because the other parents who had no audio experience are like, what's an input? What's an out? Like, what's an extension cord? You know, at least I had studio experience. I kind of knew the signal flow and.
You said they'd met you. You were setting it up, I guess, with one of their people there. He was surprised that you knew so much about it, and said, "What do you do?"
Yeah, and I said, "Well, I'm a drummer." Then it turns out the producer was a English guy, and he ended up being a Zappa fan. So I said, "Well, I played with Frank Zappa for 7 years." He's like, "You what? You what? Did you play on this record? Did you play on this record?" And we had a kind of a anyway. It was interesting.
And where can they hear
but
more?
It was not about me. It's the whole. It's
oh no. Her,
it's my daughter's. Thing I'm happy, you know.
No, you're the crew.
The crew, yeah.
Right. Sophia is her name, of
Sophia,
course.
Yeah, she goes by Sophia James now. Yeah.
Fantastic. And they can hear more of her on.
You can go to Spotify, iTunes. She's releasing new songs all the time. Yeah. She's some really wonderful, wonderful songs.
I think we need to have a family affair out here. The new family, next generation
fun,
family
yeah.
affair would be fun to do some
That'd
things
be fun.
Together.
Yeah. Yeah.
Give us a little sneak preview of some new things you're going to be doing in the lesson category. This is really exciting.
Well, one of the tunes I've always wanted to break down, which I'd never have had the opportunity, it was actually Peter Erskine gave me the idea because I once did Peter teaches at USC, one of the many things he does. He asked me at one point if I would come down to the school and just describe the kind of the rhythmic part of Alan Holdsworth's music. Because it's so different, because the way Alan often wrote music would be in rubato, and then we would get together at some point and
explain that a little bit for us.
So rubato, like a lot of classical music, slows down, speeds up, depending on the emotion of it, right? More exciting and more quicker it gets, and then he would often write the chords and the bass part, but it wouldn't be in a tempo yet, and so. Obviously, and some of it would be ballads, some of it would be faster tunes, but we would at some point get together when he's happy with the chords and the melody. We'd pick a tempo and not a pattern so much because he didn't really like repetitive patterns in drums. He thought like his concept with a whole song should be a groove, not one bar repeated over and over, two bars repeated over and over. He liked it to be freer than that. But it still had to have a nice feeling, right? So what would end up happening was he would we'd pick a tempo and it'd pick some kind of beat or floaty time, whatever it kind of felt like. And then he would fit the chords into rhythms. And then after a while, he would fix the rhythms. But often it would be a phrase, kind of like you speak. So you have a phrase, and then usually when it came to a long note, that's where he would start counting one. He would start counting a downbeat on the long note. So it might be bum, 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 gun, 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 dun, 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 one. Bum. And he would figure out how many counts that space should be, or how long that end of the phrase should be held. So it might be five quarter notes. And he might say, that feels a little too long. Let's try, six eighth notes. So we would adjust the spaces until he was happy with the feeling of it. And then that would be fixed.
You would literally compose the chart almost as a band.
Well, I would write the numbers down. I mean, some people could remember them. I like to have a visual reference first, then I'd memorize it. So the whole piece would be comprised that way. Now, some pieces are more in three or more in four, but there would always be some kind of thing about it. And Alan wouldn't really say, we're playing in seven now, but he would play the guitar part, it might be in seven. So I'd go, okay, that, and so anyway, one of the pieces I always am trying to get to, I wanted to share, because I did come up with patterns for this piece, and it was a tune called Metal Fatigue. It was off of one of his most popular records. The track that we did on it, we recorded it as a demo track, meaning a demonstration track to try to get a record deal.
Really?
For a record company. But he liked it and ended up, after we finished the demo recording of it, he said, well, I got this deal with this company and I'm just going to use it. I like it. And Jimmy Johnson played bass and Alan played guitar and I played drums and a vocalist, Paul Williams, sang. And at any rate, they kept it.
Metal Fatigue was the actual name of the CD. The CD, right?
And it was also the name of the title track, yeah. And most of it's kind of a halftime rock shuffle. Then I'll get into the whole thing. The verse pattern is really quite different. It's almost taking a reggae beat but putting it on cymbals and putting a halftime beat instead of snare drum on a tom-tom and putting the backbeat on the bass drum. Yeah, but then there's a bridge part which goes into a tempo change, a metric modulation,
and I had. But when you say a bridge part that goes into a tempo change, it just happened to end up. He had a bridge part
in a different tempo.
He heard something, and then you had to figure out how many beats were in that. And
I had to figure out the transition and the common denominator to shift the tempo mathematically.
So everybody would know where they're at as when you played it.
Yeah, and then I could set up that rhythm that was the common denominator of the two tempos, which bridged us to the new tempo.
And then
I did the opposite when we had to go back to the intro part again, or the chorus part after the faster section.
So was it you and him, and then you went to the rest of the band with it?
Yeah, he just played the guitar part, and he said, this part goes like this. And he was saying, I kind of hear it the same tempo, and I went, to me it wasn't. It was a...
Somehow you got to write it down because you got to reproduce it at one point, right?
Yeah, but it mathematically did work and it worked out. So and I was comfortable with tempo changes and metric modulations at that point because of working with Frank Zappa. Frank used to do that in between tunes.
That was my next question.
Yeah, so if this tempo, you're in 16th notes, like 1 eanda, 2 eanda, 3 eanda, 4 eanda, a simple version would be, okay, the next tempo... We're playing triplets, but those triplets are the same speed of those 16th notes. So we'll finish the tune, have a one bar drum fill in 16th notes, then those are triplets for the next shuffle. So it might be 1 eanda, 2 eanda, 3 eanda, 4 eanda, 1 eanda, 2 eanda, 3 eanda, 4, then there's your new tempo. So that's an easy example.
So you're somewhat the same thought process.
It is the same device, yeah.
Drummers of Frank Zappa's, so you've got to see. It's a kind of a documentary mini series we have here on Drum Channel.
It was really, that was a fun day.
And I never forget the one comment you had there when they were going back and forth, everybody in the show, and talking about how Frank would change the style or the genre of a song, sometimes even
on stage.
On stage, even
usually on stage. Yeah.
And so I'm going to test you now. So if he gave this sign, what did it mean?
That was Weather Report style.
It was like rain coming down.
Yeah, the great band Weather Report. There was a certain beat and kind of orchestration that the band would try to give that.
Talking
that
about
flavor.
Your experience with Frank, I know you've talked about this a lot, and we went through it in the roundtable discussion too. But back to preparedness, what's the thing that you think you, looking back at your experiences before auditioning with Frank, things that you think made you the most prepared for that you're glad you did? I mean, for you out there, hopefully it's taking the Chad Wackerman drum room course, because that's going to prepare you. But
well, I actually at one point asked Frank about that, because his music incorporated so many different genres, and you had to be a great reader, and you had to be able to kind of play in a symphony, because a lot of his music was classical. So it was all the hats. It was being a heavy metal drummer. It was being a really good jazz drummer. It was being a good Latin drummer, and a classical snare drum player. You know, or being able to play a multiple percussion part, and understanding our time signatures, and then beyond that, understanding polyrhythms and metric modulations, and reading really well, and then memorization. So that, and then also being able to improvise.
Pretty much, we got the whole boat going.
So all of it. But as far as his audition went, the first hurdle you had to get through was reading.
Let's talk about that.
And that's where pretty much everybody fell down. Because, I mean, and there, I'm sure there were, he auditioned at the time for 3 weeks, like hours a day. I think he heard 40 drummers for over 3 weeks. And I witnessed a couple auditions before me, but the couple guys, they just fell down right away at the reading part of it. So you had to pass that to get to the point where he would hear a groove.
And talking to Terry Bozzio about this a little bit, who also had the same experience as you auditioning.
Yes.
It almost wasn't as much as being able to sight read the whole thing as it was not getting lost and pretty much getting, knowing that you could. I think he was looking at knowing you had the ability to get it the second or third time because you knew what you were working with.
Yeah, I mean, some of the music was just, I don't know, honestly, anybody who could sight read it perfectly, because the classical stuff, which is the stuff he brought out for the audition, was written with all these time changes, polyrhythms, and then he orchestrated for 5 toms and 3 rototoms, and at the time, castanets, cowbell, China cymbal, ride, 2 crashes, hi-hat, bass drum. So that was all written out. And then with the polyrhythms nested inside polyrhythms and time changes and sometimes metric modulations, well, in the chart, you know, I don't know anybody on the planet, really, who could sit down and play it perfectly. Now, you could play the shape.
Right.
If you could play the shape and the polyrhythms whoever could get the closest, I think, you know, and
not lose your place. That's one of the
not big... losing your place was huge, I realized, right there watching the other couple drummers audition, because I, like in a few bars, they just lost their place. And I thought, well, I may not be able to play all this stuff, but I'm going to stay with the chart. And so if there
one
was...
One of the golden rules, at least start on time and end on time.
Yes. It's true with any reading. If there's some figures you can't play right away. And for normal Western music, it's not the end of the day if you don't hit some of the figures. It's okay. Sometimes it's a better choice, you know, depending on the arrangement.
Speaking of catching figures in a big band chart.
Yeah, sure.
What a great transition here. On Drum Channel, I know a lot of you out there are thinking, reading, oh, I don't know how to read. It's too difficult. I don't need to learn how to read. Certainly if you're pursuing any type of a career, you do need to learn how to read. What I've done on Drum Channel is taken a whole course that starts out with just learning how to literally read what's on the paper.
Mm-hmm.
With Joe Picaro, Ralph Humphrey, myself and some of the early ones, and Greg Bissonette, just showing you how to read up through 16th notes.
Great.
Then once you get that facility, the next thing would be learning how to maybe do some charts so you could transcribe a little bit what you've actually read.
Mm-hmm.
The big challenge is going from being a legitimate reader, I guess you would call it, where you're reading everything is on the page.
Like a classical percussionist, right.
To, which is what you would do when, you, you know, when you're reading charts and you're in middle school or in orchestra. But what happens when you get into a jazz band, or not even jazz in terms of jazz music, but when you get into a musical situation, like you had to do in everything you've been talking about here, chart something out. Learning how to play a big band. That's one of the courses in Chad's Drum Room, by the way.
Right, Kicking the Band.
Kicking
series,
the Band.
Yeah. And that's a methodical, step-by-step series that I thought was really necessary. And again, helping my son through his middle school and high school experiences in jazz band. It's because it's so interpretive, and it's in a way it's a lot easier than for a lot of charts, it's a lot easier than being in the orchestra and playing literal rhythms, because there's all these tricks that I talk about. I basically talk about how to sight read a chart and sound really good and confident, and know what to play and what you don't, and know what you don't need to play.
Yeah, very important, yeah.
In a musical sense. So like often if in a big band, there's things like sax solis, which is usually a more busy pattern. It features all five saxophones. It's a little bit more Charlie Parker-esque. And sometimes the chart writes out what the sax soli is, all the rhythms, like all this busy, dense patterns. It would sound ridiculous if you played that, but they have it in the chart, you know. So I show you what, how to set up that kind of thing with a little fill, then what to hit within it or at the end of it, and it just makes it a lot easier. And keeping your place, and then showing you what's really, really important, what's necessary and needed in a chart to make you sound like you're a much, much more experienced drummer.
Most of you know this, but even if you're not drummers out there watching us today, when he's talking about a chart, it's obviously the music that you have up in front of you.
Right,
a drum set. If you're in most band situations, all the other instrumentation actually has in front of them what they're supposed to play, the notes they're playing. The drummer gets this sketchy little thing that just kind of tells them what the rest of the band is doing.
Right, it will usually tell you the style. Funk, jazz, play time, have lots of slashes and then notes above it or on the staff, and I explain what that means and how to deal with that and how to be successful in it.
You have to know how to look at what's on the page, hear what the band is doing, and then interpret what you want to do, which is making it up almost on the spot, improvising as you're reading the chart. And you don't have to be that great of a reader to do this. But I mean, we're talking about Zappa, Alan Holdsworth. I mean, these are like the extremes off the map in terms of...
Yeah, but if you're talking about big band music, pop music, often you're seeing the same rhythms over and over and over. It's like you're reading the same paragraph in a book over and over and over. Sometimes they're in a different order, but...
In the Academy courses we have on Drum Channel, within the first 16 weeks, you're reading 16th notes. And that's, in most cases, the most that you're going to have to probably
read. In most cases,
read.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Any situation like that.
And as we've talked about before, the middle school, high school level of reading versus a professional level reading, it's pretty similar as far as going to a typical recording session. Again, you're not going to get too many rhythms that are beyond 16th notes.
It's just this will blow your mind, because it did mine when we did it. Part of the course, Kicking a Big Band, we actually went to the middle school where your dad was the teacher. It was a good middle school band. His bands usually go up to get into festivals and play.
Yeah, so 6th, 7th, and 8th grade students.
Okay. And so there was above average middle school band with a very decent middle school drummer. And then we had Chad sit in with the band. So, and Chad played the chart in three different basic ways. The simplest way that you would learn that would just like cover your basis and probably get you the gig, because they would know that you know where you're at and you could read the chart. And then a little bit more complex way. And then the last way was like, okay, Chad, if you were in a studio and you were playing this in a real session environment with a professional big band, just go at it and do whatever you want. The level of the band, when you actually hear the music, went from A to Z. I mean, it went from like a good middle school band to being a college band, because they were playing well. But the difference that the drummer makes in a band is just astronomical.
Well, thank you for that compliment.
Well, it's a compliment
it's
for you, true. But I'm just saying.
That's kind of the old saying, like the drummer makes, right? But a great drummer in a so-so band is going to sound like a good band, you know?
That is the saying, yeah. You can have a so-so band and a great drummer, and it'll sound better than a great band with a so-so drummer. Yeah.
But again, what the changes what I was playing was similar at every level, as far as the time and the feel, as far as the groove, that was pretty much the same on everyone. Probably the fills got fancier or more dramatic, you know, as I went.
There's a great shot in that chorus too, where you're actually playing out and doing your thing on the band, and the drummer that was in that band is standing behind you, and you just see him going like, whoa. It doesn't look like you're doing anything that much difficult, but you know the difference is day and night. I can't thank you enough for joining me today.
Thank you, Don. It's always such a pleasure. It's
amazing to catch up with you and see what's going on. And to be able to do it in person, couldn't be better.
I know. It's such a treat.
And if people are wondering, this is not just window dressing, by the way.
No, this is a
the drum set is what he's going to be sitting down and playing in just a few minutes. And it's going to be a great addition to the course, which is breaking down the Alan Holdsworth and some other surprises we have for you here.
That's true, yeah.
We'll be politically correct and put our masks back on in a moment. But in the meantime,
okay,
thank you so much, Chad. And thank you. We'll see you next time.
Thanks a lot. Bye.